Parenting. Motherhood. And that is exactly what brought me to this special edition of Parenting Essentials. And I'm super excited because I'm not alone on this special edition of Parenting Essentials. And I call this the Real Talk with Moms. And today I have moms who are here and they are ready to share their experiences with us on parenting. You are welcome. So, on today's special edition, which I'm very, very excited about, I have three wonderful moms with me and they are ready to share their experiences with us on this special edition. First, I have somebody that I love so much. I respect her a lot. I like to call her Mommy Pat. And she's been a mom for almost 2 decades. And she's here today and she's going to be sharing her experiences with us. Also, I have my very good friend, and she also has been a mom for almost a decade, and she's going to be sharing her experiences with us. And also, I have my wonderful friend who has been a caregiver but became a mom last year, and she's going to be sharing her experiences being a first-time mom. So, don't touch the dial, just stay tuned. It's going to be awesome. So if you're new here, if you're seeing my face for the first time, my name is Oye, Oye Layo, and I am your parenting coach. Don't go anywhere. Once again, you are all welcome to this special edition. I'm super delighted to be having all of you with me on this edition, and I believe it's going to be a very great time. In one sentence, can you please tell us how has parenting been? Okay, I'm going to start with it.
I'll say it's been an amazing journey of I have 3 beautiful children, and the initial bit was something that was terrifying. So it's been a wonderful journey of through. It's been close to 7 years now. I was about 7, and I have 3 beautiful children. Initially, the childbirth was terrifying, but raising those beautiful children, it was worth it after the childbirth scare.
All right, over to you, Miss Faye.
Well, I'll say it has been eye-opening because there's so many things people don't tell you, you get to experience firsthand. Mm-hmm. But so far, it's beautiful. I have a son, he's almost 7 months old, and I'm happy on this journey, and I expect to see more and learn more as we grow together.
Glad to hear. Over to you,
Mama. Yeah, I will say, you know, when it comes to parenting, it is the grace and the wisdom of God. So we want to be sincere with yourself. Starting from a childbearing is challenging. I told myself I will not have another one again when I went through the labor and the pregnancy. From the one to childbirth, it was something else. You know, but all the same, when you see your joy, when you see the gift God has given to you, because they are gifts, you appreciate God for them. The pain, everything is worthwhile. So I want to say, to some extent, it has been a beautiful journey with my kids and the kind of children God gave to me. It has been awesome. I appreciate God.
Oh, that's fantastic. You know, hearing this testimony is so amazing. And as I used to say, that parenting is a personal call and it's a ministry. And you can see this wonderful parent having a great experience. So don't be scared. If you're planning to be a mother, why not? Just keep your trust in God and everything is going to be fine.
Yeah.
Miss Faith says something that there's a lot of things that people won't tell you that you get to know. And you also said after your first pregnancy, you were thinking that you're not going to have another. So that this is going to bring me to the second question. That what are the things you wish you were told or you knew before becoming a parent? Mm-hmm. All right, I'm going to start from this way. So,
well, for me, I would say pregnancy for me was easy, so I bless God. But when I hear about people's story and everything, I was frightened at first when it has always been at the back of my mind, pregnancy, giving birth, that part was, I was always scared of it. How you're going to labor, how my mom described it and everything. So I was so scared.
And our moms have been so, like, you know, I think that they're very dramatic about it. My mom would tell me, if you cry, it's painful. If you don't cry, it's painful. So just, that's why you don't cry.
I was so scared of it. Well, God has his ways and he knows I was scared, and one thing led to another, and mine was yes. I didn't plan it, but it happened that way.
Okay.
And doctors told me not to go into labor, I shouldn't work, I shouldn't stress myself, that it had to.
I'm going to help you out.
I'm going to help you out. So it worked out. man with God. He knows what you can handle and he knows what you can't handle. Mm, yeah. So that's, everything was okay. The birth, everything was fine. He was out and he didn't cry. It was okay. Coming back home, like, after the pregnancy, when I gave birth, during the 9 months, my hands, I couldn't feel them anymore. My sister said, it's pregnancy. I'm like, seriously? When I gave birth, now I couldn't feel both hands. And I called my eldest, and she said, me too. It was like that for me. When I went to the hospital, I told the nurse, I can't feel my hands. I can't carry my son. It hurts all the time. She just looked at me and smiled. It's normal. You're not carrying your baby. I'm like,
okay, is that with CS? It happens to people with CS, right?
Yeah, I don't know if it's just particularly with CS, but it was, I don't know if it's in the drip,
maybe epidural.
It was so painful, but I had to live with it because I have to carry myself. It was just me because of the COVID, mommy could not come. And I had to bathe my baby. So it's not always. It has to be the traditional way. Just develop a way and work with it. So long as it's healthy for you
and your child,
it's okay. So you, parents or new moms, you don't have to be scared if things don't go the way you plan. God has a way. At the end of the day, you still be thankful for the way things worked out. Because that's his way.
I'm really happy to hear that.
Yeah.
It's all about the parenting being personal. It's your call. Your child is your child. I've said this over and over again. I cannot overemphasize this. Like, it's your child. The fact that the particular person is doing this way does not mean you have to do yours that way. You have to look for a way, the best way that is going to work for you.
Exactly.
So, Ms. Bumi, can you please tell us what are the things you feel, I wish I knew before I became a parent?
I'd say one of the first things is, apart from the pregnancy, one of the first things is that you need a village to raise your child. There's no one who is self-sufficient. And living abroad is a different kettle of fish. You are alone. A lot of time I've had to call my mom
to ask me.
Because we are raising millennials and it's tough. I have my child looking for the next game to play. And there was a time she downloaded a game and I found out it had chatting features. I was so scared I had to delete. Somebody was already chatting her up at age 7. I was scared out of my mind. And she continues to ask for it till tomorrow. Now I ask for God to help me. Help me explain to her why she shouldn't use such things. So these were my greatest fear and they continue to bug me because only God can grant us wisdom in such situations. So these are things that no one can really explain these things to you until you are actually in your
in this shoes yourself. But then I pray for God's guidance all the time and I never sin. So
God is always there to help us. All right, over to you, Mommy. So what were the things? I know it's been a long time, but we still like to know. I wish I knew this. I wish my mom told me this.
Yeah. When myself and my husband were caught, I said I will have 4 kids. My husband says, no, 3. But we're having 2 now. Do you know why? When it comes to your body, you must know, like my mom, if she's pregnant, she's fine. She's okay. On her day of delivery, she will take her bag, off she goes. You don't know she's going, but when it came to mine, oh my God, it was never like that. It was never like that because I thought I'm strong. I thought I'm a believer. Everything would just flow if I'm pregnant, but it wasn't like that. And it really affected you and your husband. You are just married for 3 months. You became pregnant and you can't do anything in the house. The man would come back from work to come and cook. That was how it was with me. It was, but it may not be for that. So that was a major challenge I had when it comes to pregnancy. After the baby is out, off I go, I can do anything. But during those 9 months, they are tough with me. So I would just tell people, try to understand your body. When it comes to pregnancy, body diverse. And don't talk anybody down. Don't say you are lazy, don't say you are that. We are not lazy, but our body makeup. My mother, she's a strong woman, but it wasn't with me. So what happened? So that was the only challenge I had during pregnancy. The 9 months and after 9 giving birth, I spit. You don't get it. And throughout, I was spitting, vomiting. So that was the challenge I had. But after that, raising the kids, God has been so, so faithful, because you must be occupied with your child. You must be busy with, no matter how busy you have with secular things, you must be busy with your child as a mother. If you don't want them to be influenced, like what she's saying, you must have time for them. You must check what they do out. You know, the challenges, I don't think I have much challenges raising my mom, and thank God for Doha, the environment we have. It's a very safe, the safest place to raise children, to be sincere with you. To raise children, if you are a Christian mother, I'm talking, no, praise God. If you're a Christian mother, it's the safest place to raise children, because you have time for your children. No, they are not that exposed more to where we are coming from. So that's what I would say.
I'll just ask the second question, which is going to be like continuation of what we're saying. I was going to ask Ms. Faith first about experience being a first-time mom. Mm. But I think it's already in line with what you're saying.
Okay.
So I just want you to continue and tell us, so how was your experience? You have said about the pregnancy and everything. So being a first-time mom, what were the struggle or the challenges or the goal part of it?
We raise our kids. We started from Africa. Not say like you, we are lucky. We have our mothers, like myself, my mother came, my mother-in-law came, they were with me for some
two time. Of them at the same
two
time.
Of them.
Okay.
Yeah. Two of them at the same time. So actually, sometimes what they tell you, you may not want, because of what you have read, maybe your reading book, your friends, as most of them are not believers, and you as a believer, there are some things you decided that this is what I'm going to raise my child as a child, no, but they don't have that. Mm-hmm. So they will tell you some things. Not that I'll say, no. I will listen. But I know what is, like you said, what is best for me and my kid and my children. So I listen to them, I don't throw it, because some of the things they say sometimes they are useful. So maybe you have to back the baby. They said back the baby before we go from you. How are you going to do when we are not here? So I have to back the baby, the baby in their presence. How are you going to feed the baby, bathing the baby? I have to bathe the baby before they go. I have to do those things. How to feed when the baby is hiccuping, what to do. They taught me those things. But when it comes to maybe cleanliness, they are old now, changing your baby's diaper, you can see, I don't want to use that again. So it is because of the health of the baby. It may tell you something, but it is not, it is you that will know, like, what suits your baby. So that is, they were there for me, but I use my discretion as well on what to give my baby. When the baby should sleep, they want to cut the baby for you because they are there. But when they go, it will be only you and your husband. So please, let the baby stay on the bed now. Because if the baby is used to hand, it is another problem.
True. A lot of people can't really say, please, I want my baby down. And they don't want to, people are sick. That's why I made a video sometimes about
my mother. Why would I want to talk to my mother? I should want to talk, but the way you say it matters. The way you say it matters. Mama Joy, so that please let the baby lay on, sleep on her, so that you will not get used to her. You are going to go back. It will be only me and my husband.
I'm sure.
No, why not? And even your mother-in-law, the relationship between both of you is your mother too.
Mm-hmm.
Your mother-in-law is your mother. It's your mother. So why would you not be able to relate with your mother-in-law? So I was okay with both of them. Just I was cooking for both of them. They are taking care of the baby.
Oh,
even
my
though.
God.
Anyway, I was more cooking.
I can imagine. I really like what Mommy Pat said about, you listen, but you listen and you just pick what is good for you. Take the bone, even if there is no meat. Suck the marrow. You can throw the bone away, like my papa said sometimes back. So, and I remember that's gonna be my mom came when I had the twins.
Okay.
And I know she's very good. She's been the mother to all in our area. But ever, I was not ready to rely on her.
Mm.
And she's the kind of mother that she's also ready to listen.
Mm.
And she knows, like, this is my child. I know her. She was so careful and like, how do you want it? How do you want it? And I said, okay. Even she was trying to bait one of them, and I said, I don't really want that. She was ready. She wanted me to teach her.
Mm.
And I was like, do it like this.
Mm.
And after I said, don't worry, I'll just do this by myself. And she was very
she
happy
was
about
cool with it.
And she was very happy about that. So your child is still your child. Even if your mommy, your in-law, sometimes some in-laws can be so funny. Hey, no, it's okay. We just have to apply wisdom. As long as you're doing it with, just apply wisdom. Your child is your child. How was it like your first experience being a mother?
I'll say,
the pregnancy was fairly easy. I was alone.
And I remember, sorry to cut you short, I remember we were actually expecting a boy.
Yes,
for your first child. And everything was gotten from the state, and the baby came and they became a girl. I remember.
She came out a girl.
Really?
She was under 5.4 kg.
Yeah, she was very big, so they couldn't know that she's not a boy.
It was hard. I had a C-section, but it was the most difficult thing I had ever gone through in my life. And, like I said, you need a village. The only thing that got me through it was I had a
people
village.
People around you.
Yes. My mom was there. My brother was there. And my brother is so soft. He would look at me and say, Bumi, go to bed. Don't worry. I'll take care of her. I'm like, she's 1 month old. Don't worry. And so that was what got me through. My husband was on the phone, of course. But he didn't know what I was going through. And that was another pain on its own.
Yeah.
You would find a lot of women who don't have their husbands with them at the time when they give birth. And sometimes the kind of discussion you have will move you to tears just because he's not there. He doesn't understand what you feel. So those times were the most difficult times for me. As at the beginning. The second and third one were fine because we were together. He could see me, he could judge by himself to think, you know, this girl is tired or this girl needs a break. But sometimes when the challenges come, it just takes the grace of God to continue in those situations. Other than that, I think I had the best of time raising. My kids don't cry. I've never had a child that cries. They sleep throughout, they eat well. But because I time them, and this my mom taught me to do. So I time my kids every 3 hours, they have food.
Okay.
The first bottle maybe at 6, the next one you already know in your mind is at 9. So initially every 3 hours, and then with every 3 hours, I do a diaper change. So my kids sleep throughout the night.
That was really what I did.
Yeah, throughout the night, it was amazing. I could have my girl in the house for months and she was not crying.
Wow.
So that was one of the blessings I had as the first time mom, all three of them. So for every new mom, this is my advice to them. Time your child. If you have the strength, bathe them at night, give them a massage. Your life will be easier for him. My husband didn't even know we had a child in the house.
That's good.
You'll go to bed and wake up like, the baby didn't cry. She didn't cry because I already knew she was time for her to eat, and then I gave her food and we both went back
to sleep.
So he said, this is amazing. Now he's saying, I want the fourth child. I'm like,
beautiful. I didn't have that experience actually about maybe feeding.
Yeah, for me also, I actually did exactly the same. Yes, and I think nobody told me. I was changing them every 3 hours, feeding them every 3 hours. And I tried as much as possible when I was still breastfeeding them to breastfeed them at the same time. Because I also
sleep with them.
So I'll just, when they were sick kind of little, I'll just sit on the bed, have one pillow here, okay, you guys go ahead, let's do this together. And sometimes they are breastfeeding and I'm just dozing and I'm
like,
because of my mom, I don't want her to stay awake at night. So I didn't even keep them with her. She wanted, I said, go back to your room and sleep. I didn't want to picture that she was around. So when she left, they were barely 3.5 months. And I was like, okay, Holy Spirit, you're going to help me. But for 1.5 years after that, I was alone with them. And everything went great. So I thank God for that. So I would like Miss Faith to actually share her experience because, it was during COVID. The delivery was during COVID. Mommy, none of the grandmas came. And how has it been, being the first time mom and the experience so far?
Well, everything was okay. During the pregnancy stage, everything was okay. I think at some point I forgot I was pregnant because it was just easy. Yeah, it was very easy. And I'm a teacher, I was in school and nobody knew. Everything was okay, everything was fine, up until they told us to start working from home and all that. The challenge was when it was time to give birth. So normally here, a husband is not to go with you, but at least somebody else could go, a lady, but because of the COVID, there were restrictions. So no one could go with me, it was just me. I was the only one, and it was CS. So while I was trying to recover from the pain, I had to carry my child when he cries and everything, no one to help me. And again, he was refusing to suck because as soon as they gave birth to him, they gave him a bottle. That was a problem. So when it was now time for him to suck, it was finding it difficult. He wanted the bottle.
It's always like that.
So, but God blessed some of the nurses. She came. She was like, okay, what's the problem? I'm like, he's not taking my breast. And she said, what's it? She said, can I? I said, sure. She said, there's milk. Why is he not taking it? Maybe it's because they gave him a bottle. And all that. At some point, I was so weak. I remember I gave birth on a Sunday, so on Monday the pain was so severe and there was no nurse because they were all busy because mothers had given birth and just only the nurses that were permitted to assist. So they just come once and there are so many people to go to. I was like, Holy Spirit, you need to send someone now. And my son was crying and you can't leave your bed because someone came, a nurse just came, and she said, Mama, are you okay? I said, I'm not okay. She said, what's the problem? He's crying, I'm going through pain. Then she was like, where's your nurse? I said, she's not answering the call. Then she just took the baby from me, went to feed him, change him, and then the nurse came and gave me some pain relievers. And after that night, I got myself back and I could handle him and everything. And coming back home, I had to pump and give it to him because he refused to take the bottle. But that's God for hubby. He took leave, 1 month leave, he took his leave. So he was with me. Sometimes you tell me, go to bed, I'll stay with him. I'm like, are you sure? He said, just go and sleep, I'll take care of him. So both of us were learning on the job because no parents and COVID. We're also scared for people to come to help. We just had to do it that way. But bless God for my son. He doesn't cry except when he needs
a diaper change. If you see
a diaper change or
he has to be smiling.
Yes, apart from that, he doesn't really cry.
Troubles.
Yeah, he doesn't trouble. And I put him in a routine. So it helped him sleep through the night. But whenever he takes his vaccine, it's like everything's
started. Yeah,
it's
normal.
It's when we tried. Yeah. I'll have to keep him by my side because he'll cry and the pain and all that. But after that, we go back to the routine. And what I mean is that God will not give you what you cannot handle. I remember telling my mom that I'd given birth, and she was like, what if you had your quads? What would they have done in this era of COVID? I said, that's what God gave me, a single test to practice.
We are still expecting those cards. I didn't change that name. They're still there. I'm not God.
She was asking me, so do you still want them? I said, yes. But now, I want
more experience.
I would say, yes. I would prefer it to be triplets. So one is already there. Yes.
You know, because we had quite a number of people who delivered during the COVID, and I was like, in my head, what is going to happen? Because I know how much I've been to the hospitals for delivery, and I always enjoy it. I just be picturing that. You know, sometimes in here, where we live, the husband will not even be aware that the wife delivered, because they will not even remember to call, even without COVID, if there is nobody there. Yes, because I remember I met one, it was at Alwakra Hospital years back. And then the man was outside. I spoke to the man, are you okay? Because I saw he was not happy. Said, I've been here for 2 hours. Don't have family or friends here. And my wife has been inside since yesterday. Nobody's giving me
any information.
I said to him, don't worry, just give me the name of your wife. Then I went inside and I spoke to the nurse. I want to see my sister. Of course, not my sister because we are not even the same skin. So I got there and I saw the woman already delivered. And she told me, I've delivered about 4 hours ago or something like that. I said, okay. I came, your husband is outside, I spoke to her, then I took pictures
to show him.
Congratulations. He was like, you know, I was just thinking about it. That was even without COVID.
Yeah, I think now there's been some changes because when I went to give birth, it was at alcohol, they told me, give me your husband's number so we can call him and alert him that. Because there's no way he can go down. And sometimes they tell you to all your valuables, give it to your husband. They don't want to be responsible for anything. So even your phone and everything
will not be with you.
Will not be with you, to be with him. So they will get his number and let him know that you've given birth so he can.
And I think maybe that was because it wasn't COVID. They expect somebody to be with them. Maybe, I'm not sure. So during the COVID, I was like, our ladies are going to, they're going to call.
Not in Africa. Your husband enters the labor room with you. Yes. He's seen the action. Everything you are doing. In my case, everything he was seeing, everything.
I do wish my husband.
I tell you, everything.
Ah, really?
Yeah. everything.
I'm not sure. I want. You know, I wasn't sure. I never thought about I want my husband to be in the labor room with me because I know my husband. My hobby.
My husband was school with it.
And we end up having two babies. So, when I let him, I'm fine. Don't worry. Because I remember when I went to, they're like. Even up to the last moment, they were telling me, you have twins, why not just go for CS?
Mm.
The nurse like, somebody deliver at this point, it was CS. I said, okay.
Mm. As long as I don't want it.
I don't want that, I would deliver. But they're like, you know, I thank God for that. He really gave me strength. And even during the delivery, he gave me the strength to the last minute. And I told my husband, this and this, pray about it. Because the Holy Spirit will always alert you somewhere. Pray about it, like, delivering the first and the second one is going to be CS. I said, this, they want to play that prank. And it almost happened. And about 15 doctors were over me and I was like, take out of me. I was hearing. I just smiled. She's still smiling. She's still smiling. Are you okay? Esther, they were calling. I was just smiling. I was just praying with him. Holy Spirit, this one did not happen.
What was happening?
Probably the second baby came out. It's God.
It's God.
And parenting is personal. And we are all sharing our experiences. You know, you can hear some, like, not so like, maybe it wasn't a very nice experience during pregnancy. Some people have a very good experience during pregnancy. I don't want you to make that your standard. We are not here to scare you or scare anyone. The fact that some of us had a very, maybe not very good experience during pregnancy does not mean you're going to have the same.
Not at all.
So, but you have to still stay positive that you are going to have a very nice and smooth pregnancy.
Yeah.
So it's possible, but you have to believe it. You have to believe it. So now I want us to talk about, you know, sometimes some things work during the first child. But you want to, so you think, it worked this time. And you want to do the same the second baby and it never worked. So I want us to talk about things like that. Maybe it was a routine or particular, whatever techniques or method you use for the first child.
I think when it comes to my case, it was when winning my baby, like my son. He didn't take baby food. He didn't take baby food. He was taking breast milk and maybe preparing, making some baby food, you know, for him at home. So when, maybe that was the mistake I made, I'm not really sure. So when they were telling me, if you don't stop the breast, because almost a year and 2 months, you know, I was still breastfeeding. And it wasn't eating very well.
So enjoying the milk.
Yeah, that told me, okay, stop the breast milk now, otherwise this baby will not eat. So myself too, that's how I swing into action. Yes, I'm going to take. But I discovered that when I did that, when I took no stopping from breastfeeding, the feeding was now bad. It wasn't eating very well again. So I had to take him to the doctors. This is what is happening. This baby is not eating very well. He said, he needs to stop it, but maybe the way it happens, you know, I should have introduced more food to him than before I stopped, because I introduced this pap. Because it doesn't take baby food. It doesn't take Cerelac. But the pap, he enjoyed it like her. We have to make it ourselves. The millet, adding this, blending it, sieving it. So that is what, and no this stuff like that. But we didn't introducing other food more to him at that stage. We didn't really quite do it. It was when he has maybe grown up, maybe like 2, you know, at least we started giving maybe beans, Indomie. So till now, he affects his eating, the way he eats. Like I was sharing with him, praise does not eat. We'll tell you, I'm okay, I'm good. From morning to afternoon, until I come, what you do eat, I will now start organizing. It doesn't care. But my second child, not like that. My daughter is not like that. So sometimes we need to be careful. You know, when taking some action concerning our children, some people will tell you do this now, but that's not the right when to do it. You study your child. I think that is where the mistake. You need to study that child. If you want to stop breastfeeding a child, look for various alternatives on ground that the baby will eat that, and he will enjoy eating. Not that you'll be forcing the baby to eat it. What the baby will enjoy eating, look for it. But me, I did not look for many alternatives, you know, Indomie, tea. What is in tea? You think they will not hold the baby for long? Look for what will hold the baby not for long. But I think that is the mistake where I, when it comes to my son eating habit, that's the only problem I'm having with him.
Okay. And I think you started the answers to my next question, which says, what are the things you would have done differently? Or if you are to have another baby, what are the things you would do differently? So the question that we're going to answer together so that to save time, what changed between the first child, the second child, and the third child? And what if you are to have another baby? Even I know some of us will be doing that. But I think I have that thing that I would have done differently, and I'm going to share my own side of the story. So what are the things you would have done differently? But I would want to know, what are the differences between the first child and the second child?